بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. كل سنة وحضراتكم طيبين جميعا بمناسبة شهر رمضان الكريم، وأهلا وسهلا ومرحبا بكم في إحدى فعاليات التعليم الطبي المستمر الـ Continuous Medical Education للجمعية المصرية للطب النفسي الـ Egyptian Psychiatric Association برعاية شركة فاركو للأدوية رائدة صناعة الدواء في مصر والشرق الأوسط. معاكم أنا محمود ريحان، برودكت مانجر فاركو فارماسيوتيكالز. ان شاء الله النهارده هنتشرف بوجود قامه وعلامه من يعني اساتذه الطب النفسي في مصر. معانا ان شاء الله النهارده الاستاذ الدكتور اسامه الخولي، استاذ الطب النفسي بجامعه اسكندريه. ان شاء الله هيسعدنا بفروتفول سيشن ان شاء الله. ولكن خلونا في الاول نتشرف بان احنا نقدم دكتور عطيه زدان، سيلز دايركتور فاركو فارماسيوتيكالز.
يا محمود، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أنا عطية زيدان، سيلز دايركتور شركة فاركو فارماسيوتيكال. في الحقيقة أنا برحب بأول سبيكر أستاذ الدكتور أسامة الخولي، بروفيسور أوف سايكايتري أليكسندريا يونيفرسيتي، وبرحب بحضراتكم جميعا في السايكايتريك ويبينار سبونسرد بفاركو فارماسيوتيكال واندورسد بالإيجيبشن سايكايتريك أسوشيشن. وأتمنى لحضراتكم طبعا يعني سهرة رمضانية مفيدة ونافعة مع الأستاذ الدكتور أسامة الخولي. في الحقيقة خليني في الأول أتقدم بالتهنئة لحضراتكم جميعا ولنا جميعا بحلول شهر رمضان المعظم، عاده الله علينا باليمن والبركات. وخلوني طبعا أتقدم برضو بالشكر لحضراتكم وجميع الطواقم الطبية المصرية المخلصة على العمل الدؤوب والتفاني في مواجهة كوفيد 19 بانديميك. ربنا يسلم بلدنا بإذن الله والإنسانية جميعا، ويطلعنا منها أقوى ومجتمعاتنا أقوى وقادرة على الإنتاج وعلى العمل بشكل أفضل بإذن الله. في الحقيقة إن التجمع العلمي اللي إحنا بصدده النهاردة هو مثال على التعاون المثمر بين شركة فاركو وبين الإيجيبشن سايكياتريك أسوشيشن وبين كل الميديكال كوميونيتي في مصر. بالنسبة لشركة فاركو فارماسيوتيكال، فاركو فارماسيوتيكال is the mother company of فاركو جروب founded by دكتور حسن حلمي in 1983. Eight healthcare companies are operating in the pharmaceutical field for development, manufacturing, marketing, distributing, and exporting of a comprehensive array of generics and branded generic drugs under the name of Farco, along with rising number of licensed pharmaceutical products. Farco is the largest manufacturer of pharmaceuticals in the MENA region, founded on research, formulation, manufacturing, and commercialization of pharmaceutical products. Today, Farco employs over 9,000 employees and has over 750 million packs product in 2019. Ranking as the leader in the Egyptian pharmaceutical market, Farco also export to over 50 countries around the world. Farco works toward one goal, which is to provide highly effective and safe pharmaceutical product to patients at an affordable price, which is our requirements بالنسبة لاقتصاديات دولتنا ودولنا في هذه الإيرا. At the end, أنا عايز أقول لحضراتكم الـ founder speech بتاعت دكتور حسن. As the largest manufacturer in Egypt, we have the duty toward providing safe and effective pharmaceutical products that are within every patient reach. في الحقيقة أنا بشكر حضراتكم على وقتكم، وأتمنى لكم ليكتشر موفقة بإذن الله وبرودكتيف ومع الأستاذ الدكتور أسامة الخولي بإذن الله. شكرا.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. كل سنة وانتم طيبين، رمضان كريم علينا وعليكم، وكل الشكر لشركة فاركو على دعوتي ان انا اكون معاكم النهاردة. اعرفكم بنفسي، انا دكتور أسامة الخولي، استاذ طب النفسي جامعة اسكندرية. لازم اشكر استاذ معتز من شركة ايكوم، ودكتور محمود ودكتور عطية من شركة فاركو على اهتمامهم بتنظيم هذه الندوة المسائية. أتمنى أن أنا مبقاش ضيف تقيل عليكم. ما أقدرش أبتدي البرزنتيشن من غير ما أشكر الجمعية المصرية للطب النفسي على تنظيمها لأكثر من ويبينار متتالي لرعاية الأطباء النفسيين، سواء الجينيور أو حتى زمايلنا وأساتذتنا. وجزيل الشكر طبعا لرئيس الجمعية دكتور ممتاز عبد الوهاب اللي اداني الفرصة ان انا اكون معاكم النهاردة. واللي يعرف دكتور ممتاز هيعرف ان احنا كسايكاتريست بقى ورانا ظهر قوي، انسان ممكن يقف ورانا وممكن يساعدنا وممكن يخلينا نوصل الرسائل بتاعتنا اللي احنا عايزين نوصلها لزمايلنا والاطباء الجونيور، وبيساعدنا كمان ان احنا نأبجريد اور سيلف، سواء ان احنا نسمع لبعض او نسمع البرزنتيشنز لبعض ونسمع الادفانسز اللي بتحصل في الطب النفسي خلال الفتره اللي فاتت. البرزنتيشن بتاعتي النهارده عن وسهل جدا ان اي سايكاتريست يقدر يشخص عيان ديبرشن لوجيك. اعتقد حتى مش السايكاتريست بس ممكن يشخص عيان ديبرشن، ده حتى الدكتورز اللي بالادر سبيشاليتي يقدر يشخص عيان الديبرشن. اعتقد ان كنت لو شفت واحد زي الصوره دي هتبان ان هي واحده مكتئبه وقد تكون متالمه. يعني البينتينج ده في اخر في 1860 سماها البينتر ميلانو كولي، يعني اكتئاب. ومعنى برضو الصورة لو احنا شايفينها وشايفين الست دي حاطة ايديها على بطنها وبتتألم، ممكن واحد تاني يقولك لا دي واحدة بتتألم، ده ألم. فهل في علاقة ما بين الدبريشن والألم؟ زي ما قلنا طبيعي ان اي انسان او اي سايكاتريست يقدر يشخص الدبريشن، مش محتاج انك انت تاخد دكتوراه ولا ماجستير عشان تقدر تشخص دبريشن، ده انت وانت جونيور تعرف تشخص واحد عنده اكتئاب. بس المشكلة لو جالك العيان ما قالكش ان هو عنده اكتئاب، والمشكلة الأكبر لما هذا العيان بيروح لدكتور مش تخصصه نفسية وما بيقولوش ان هو عنده اكتئاب، لأنه بيبقى عنده أعراض جسمانية أخرى، هذه الأعراض تغطي أعراض الاكتئاب. لو بصينا على الجملة دي عجبتني جدا وأنا بحضر المحاضرة، كلنا عارفين ماتسلو، ماتسلي ده واحد من او هنري ماتسلي ده واحد من البريتش سايكاتريست، بيقول ان الحزن اللي ما يخرجش في دموع بيخلي الاعضاء الجسمانيه تسفر تويب. The sorrow which has no vent in tear may make other organ weep. Which means ان ممكن يجي لك الدبريشن من غير دبريشن. جاي لك الدبريشن just by physical symptoms. And these physical symptoms هتبقى masked المانيفستيشنز بتاعت الدبريشن. يعني العيان اللي بيجي لدكتور البطنة بيشتكي من آلام أو صداع أو مغص أو إسهال، غالبا ما بيقولهوش أنا مكتئب، بيقوله على المغص والإسهال والصداع والترجيع وألم الظهر and so on. ودكتور البطنة أو الجي بي أو whatever the specialty is مسؤول أنه يعالج هذه الأعراض، والمشكلة أنه بيديلها علاج لكن الأعراض ما بتروحش. فبيبتدي يدور، بيبتدي يعمل investigations، وبيبتدي يعمل even invasive investigations زي endoscopy وساعات MRI وحاجات، وساعات بنشوف حالات اتعمل لهم حتى exploration surgical exploration، يقول لهم أنا مش عارف ألامك دي لغاية فين، طب تعالى نفتح وندور. مدى أهمية إن الاكتئاب يظهر بهذه الأعراض خلى أي واحد منكو أو من الجينيور سايكاتريست اللي نفسه يعمل معادلة مثلا أو مش لازم جينيور سايكاتريست، حتى الجي بي او الطلبه وهم بيخرجوا من كليه الطب وعايزين يعملوا معادله امريكيه او انجليزيه، بارت 1 في المعادلات دي هي عباره عن بيولوجي وفيسيولوجي واناتومي وفيسيولوجي اند سو اون، وتلت الاسئله اللي بتيجي في بارت 1 سايكاتريست، لان تلت الحالات اللي هتجيلك whatever your speciality will be is related to the psychiatry is not related to your speciality. يعني تلت الحالات اللي بتيجي في الانترنال ميديسن، تلت الحالات اللي بتيجي لبتوع الهيباتولوجي، وتلت الحالات اللي بتيجي حتى العينين الجراحة غالبا they are a psychiatric disease or a symptoms of psychiatric stress. الأجندة النهاردة هنتكلم على الـ 6 points دولت. depression قد إيه ممكن is a systemic and or painful illness، يعني ده مش mind disease بس، ده ممكن يأفكت all the body زي ما مادسلي قال إنه ممكن make other organs weep، وإن الـ pain could be a risk factor for depression. وهنتكلم على spectrum of disorders or syndromes characterized by pain and functional disturbance without organic cause. هنفهم ايه الباثوفيسيولوجي بتاع الحاجات دي، وهنتكلم على therapeutic options، واخيرا هنتكلم على الفيوتشرز اللي جاي عشان نحاول نعالج الحالات دي، وقد ايه ان الحالات دي بتبقى difficult to the psychiatrist and difficult to the general practitioners او the internal medicine to diagnose، لان العيان لغاية دلوقتي ما قالش ان انا عندي اكتئاب، كل اللي قاله عبارة عن systemic manifestations. First point, depression as a systemic or painful illness. كلنا عارفين الكريتيريا بتاعت الدبريشن، depressed mood وانهيدونيا ولوس الفيستيم وimpaired memory and so on. بس بصوا على الفيزيكال signs of depression. تخيلوا ان الاعراض الفيزيكال بتاعت الدبريشن اكتر من الايموشنال signs. يعني ممكن العيان ما يجيلكش بالتيبل اللي جاي على الشمال ده، لكن هيجيلك غالبا بالاعراض دي كلها. And at this time الجنرال براكتيشنال او الانترنال ميديسن بجد عنده حق، الراجل ما قاليش انا مكتئب، وما قاليش ان انا عندي لو سيلف استيم ولا ان انا انكشس ولا انا عندي نيجاتيف ثوتس. الراجل قاعد يقول لي صداع ووجع واجهاد وما بنامش والام في جسمي والام في الجي اي تي وفوميتنج وكونستيبيشنز ومش وانا عندي سيكشوال امبيرمنت وعندي امبوتنس، او واحده ست عندها منسترويد ريجولاريتي. ايش عرفني ان هي ديبرست؟ ما قالتش. ودي المشكلة، ان اغلب البريزنتيشن زي ما هنشوف بتاعت الدبريشن بتيجي in the form of these physical symptoms. تخيلوا ان حوالي 70% من الدبريست patient present only with these physical symptoms. يعني 70% من الحالات only present with physical symptoms. مهمة قوي كلمة only دي، يعني هو ما قالكش انا depressed، ولا قالك انا متضايق ولا مخنوق ولا عايز اولع في نفسي ولا مكتئب and so on. ففي الاستادي دي لما يقول لك حوالي 70% جايين في الفيزيكال سيمتومز، فاحنا لازم نهتم بالفيزيكال سيمتومز بتاعت الدبريشن وازاي نقدر نشخصها وازاي نعرف نعالجها. شوف في الاستادي ده ان البيشنتس انيشيالي بريزنتد تو ذا برايمري كير فيزيشن ان انذر استادي حوالي 80%، يعني في الاستادي كانت 70% وهنا حوالي 80%. They are only present with physical complaint rather than the psychological symptoms. وكلما زادت النمبر of the physical complaint كلما زادت البوسيبيليتي ان يبقى في anxiety or mood disorder. يعني لو عند واحد عنده من 4-5 complaint، تخيلوا ان ال percentage انه يبقى عندهم anxiety or depression may reach to 40%. العيانين اللي جايين ب multiple physical complaint are more likely that they have a psychological problem. المشكلة ان الدكاترة بيعتبروا يا عم انت عندك حالة نفسية، بيتفهم من اللفظ ده للمريض او حتى بيتفهم عن دكاترة البطنة. اغلب زمايلنا بتوع البطنة او اغلب سبايتنا بتوع الجراحة يقولك يا عم يعني ما عندوش حاجة. انا عادي بدي البرزنتيشنز دي عشان اوضح ان في حاجة، وفي حاجة هتحصل، وفي حاجة هنشوفوها في الباثوفيسيولوجيكال ميكانيزم تؤكد ان احنا في عندنا مشكلة، وان الناس دول بيحصل لهم disturbance in the neurotransmitter in the brain and in the spinal cord and even in the organs which Maxley قال ان هي بتويب. ايوة دي بتويب، بتتعذب، وحنشوف بتتعذب ازاي. شوفوا ال predictions of the physical symptoms ان يبقى واحد عنده depression according to these symptoms. يعني لو واحد جاي لك by sleep disturbance you have 60% predictive value ان الشخص ده عنده depression. مجرد الانسومنيا او الفاتيج الاثنين حوالي 60%. multiple physical complaint involve حوالي 56% من patients actually they have physical symptoms. انا عايز اشوف بقى في الحاجات الشورتنس اوف بريث، يعني حاجه بسيط، واحد مش عارف ياخد نفسه، مش لازم يبقى عنده كورونا على فكره. اغلب الحالات اللي بنشوفهم دلوقتي دكتور انا مش عارف اخد نفسي وعندي مشكله ان انا يمكن يبقى عندي كورونا، دول غالبا بيطلع عندهم انكزايتي اور ديبرشن اور ايفن هايبوكوندرايسيس. تعالوا نشوف بس اخر جمله تحت، ان الباك بين والماسكولوسكليتال بين سوري والتشيست بين ار اسوشييتد وذ جريتر سيفيريتي اوف ديبرشن. يعني الناس اللي بيشتغلوا او بيشتكروا من الام في الصدر وألام في الجسم وألام في الظهر، خياله كان في مصر بقى ده نص ستات مصر بيشتكوا من ألام في الجسم. مش مقول ان كلهم عندهم ديبرشن، لكن لو كان مفيش سبب أورجانيك للبين ده السيفيريتي بتاعت الديبرشن بيبقى اعلى من الكومبلين التاني. السوماتيك بريزنتيشن اوف ديبرشن ده هاف ا ديفرنت ابييرنس، يعني بيظهر بالذات في الالدرلي. صعب قوي ان واحد كبير او راجل كبير بالذات لو راجل متدين شوية يجي ويقول انا مكتئب وعايز اكره نفسي وعايز انهي حياتي. انا بيشتغل معايا ناس في العيادة كبار السن شوية مساعدين وبيساعدوني في تنظيم العيادة، فعمره ما قال لي انا مكتئب. وانا اذا كان انا ببقى مكتئب، الحياة اللي احنا فيها والاسترس اللي احنا فيه حتى بيخاف. بحس ان الناس الكبار صعب يقول انا مكتئب لان بيعتبر ان ده تقليل في ايمانه او تقليل في رجولته. يعني ايه انا مكتئب؟ يعني ايه انا خايف يا دكتور؟ لا، كله بامر ربنا وان شاء الله. هيظهر الخوف او القلق او الاكتئاب في صوره فيزيكال سامبلز، ففي ايج بايس ان اكتر في الالدرلي يظهروا في الصوره دي، اكتر برضو في الومن ان هم يجوا لهم السوماتيك بريزنتيشن اوف ديبرشن. وده طبيعي جدا، صعب جدا ان واحده ست مثلا جوزها شقيان ومن الشغل اليوم كله بتيجي في اخر اليوم تقول له ما عملتلكش فطار عشان انا مكتئبه وماليش نفس للدنيا، لانه غالبا هيفتح لها دماغ. طب ما احنا كلنا مكتئبين. فالاسهل للسب كونشوس ان هو يظهر الفيزيكال سيمتومز، وممكن يبقى مقبول عند الزوج ان هي تقول له انا ظهري واجعني جدا وعندي صداع، ساعتها هيقبل انه ما تعملوش فطار ولا تعمل له غدا انسوع. فالوومن ار مور بريزنتد وذ فيزيكال سيمتومز عن المان، وايل بيور ديبرشن without physical symptoms equal to men and women. The presentation كمان have a cultural bias. الدول المتحضرة الناس قادرين ان هم يقول ان انا عندي اكتئاب عن الناس اللي في الدور developing او الغير متحضرة او اللي ما عندهمش higher education. بصوا على الستادي دي هتلاقوا البرزنتيشن بتاعت somatic presentations of depression عالية في تركيا، في جريس، في نيجيريا، في تشاينا، وتقل كلما زادت تحضر الدولة. يعني تخيلوا في فرنسا 45%، في تركيا 95% somatic presentation of depression، مع ان البريفالنس ما اختلفتش كتير. فكلما زاد تحضر الدولة كلما قادر المريض ان هو يقول ان انا مكتئب ويقول ان انا متضايق ويقول ان انا بفكر في الانتحار، وكلما قلت الديفلوبينج بتاعت او قل التقدم بتاعت الدولة كلما كان السوماتيك بريزنتيشن هو الاكثر. تعالوا نشوف طب الفيزيشن بيرد ولا لا، بيستجيب ولا لا. تخيل ان 22% من الدكاتره ممكن يشخص ديبرشن اكوردنج تو ذا سوماتيك كومبلين، لكن ال 77% محتاجين ان الراجل يقول انا مكتئب وعايز اولع في نفسي. 22% بس هو اللي ممكن يلقط ان السوماتيك كومبلين دي ممكن تبقى presentation of depression. Okay. According to the DSM-5, somatic presentation of depression did not be included in the subclassification or subspecifications of the major depressive disorder. They include anxious and mixed, melancholic features, atypical features, catatonic features, peripartum and seasonal pattern, but they did not include somatization as a part of the somatic presentations of depression. If there is a difference between depressed patients who are somatizing and depressed patients who are not somatizing, DSM-5 did not include this diagnostic criteria in their subclassifications. We usually receive questions from our students that why this subclassification? Because there is a difference in the treatment plan. Anxious patients will not be treated like patients with melancholic features. As you know, melancholic features, maybe you need EST, maybe you need SNRI. Anxious patient may be responding to the SSRI. Atypical features will never respond to the tricyclic antidepressant. Mood congruent psychotic features need antipsychotic with the antidepressant. This is logic in DSM-5 because they made the classifications because there is a difference in the treatment plan. But if there is a difference in the treatment plan between somatic patients or depressed patients who are somatizing and depressed patients who are not somatizing, DSM-5 did not identify this as an important point. Although ICD-10 identified difference between somatic presentations and patients with somatic presentation and patients without somatic presentation as a differentiating point. And that's why they usually say DSM-5 is not culturally oriented and it's not clinically oriented. It's based on the classifications and based on the therapeutic plans, while maybe ICD-10 was more accurate in subclassification of depressive episodes, either it includes somatic syndromes or does not include somatic syndromes. And the challenge in the therapy also that in treatment of patients with major depression, the least symptoms which could be resolved is the somatic symptoms. You will see that in this study, the depressive symptoms improve as much as the positive well-being, while the painful and non-painful somatic symptoms does not improve as the depressed symptoms. So this may be the residual symptoms, which will never be searched for by the physician. So the physician does not search for the somatic symptoms. So they just ask the patient, you are okay now, you are not depressed, you don't have anhedonia, you have the lacking of interest, you are going well with the lacking of interest, now you are enjoying some stuff. Yes, but you did not ask for the headache or the back pain or the GIT abscess. And even if the patient reported to the physician, sometimes the physician attributes these physical symptoms to the drug. So it's related, it's a side effect of the drugs or something else. You should go to a orthopedics or a GP or whatever to search for other pain like headache or GIT disturbance. And when we predict the failure for the response of the SSRI in a depressed patient, they found that the more the severity of the pain, the more the possibility of the failure to the treatment of the depression. Like when if a patient had a severe pain, this predict treatment failure if you did not concentrate on this pain as a point you should ask for and follow it. And these residual symptoms, as you know all that patients with residual depressive symptoms are usually able to have a high rate of relapse. So if you cannot treat the old symptoms of depression in the depressive episodes, this increases the risk of the relapse. So what's happening if these residual symptoms is a somatic symptom? Because you are not concentrated with these somatic symptoms, this is the possibility that it will be maintained as residual symptoms. And this means if you are not following it and not treating it adequately, you will have a problem that the risk of the relapse will be higher and higher. And that's what we are seeing in most of our patients, that we are concentrated on the psychological symptoms and we ignore the physical symptoms. And in this case, the relapse rate will be increased. To the other point, is pain by itself could be a risk factor for depression? The only one who can see pain as a risk factor for depression is someone who is listening to us today and he has what we call a chronic pain. Patients who have a long-term bone pain or orthopedics pain or GIT pain, if the pain is chronic, this increases the risk for relapse. You will see in this study, they search for the psychological disturbance or mood disturbance and the prevalence of mood disturbance and anxiety in patients with a chronic pain. Only about 50% of them with a chronic pain, they have only pain. And the other 50%, they have either major depression or an anxiety or both. So almost about 45% of patients with a chronic pain, they have a risk for depression and anxiety. And this was astonishing to me. Like in the general pain populations, the percent raised to about 20%. We know that the general populations, the prevalence of depression is 10%, 10 to 12, according to the studies. And the highest prevalence of pain was in the dental and facial pain clinic. I don't know why. I tried to search for the study. They did not give explanation. Like patients with the dental pain, we all have a problem with our teeth, but you know that patients with a facial pain, like trigeminal neuralgia, dental pain, who have a chronic pain, about 85%, they have prevalence of depression. This is a very big number. In orthopedic clinics, about 50%, they have, or 56%, they have depression. And the anxiety is higher in patients who have back pain, for example, in this study. So the prevalence of anxiety and depression is higher in the pain disorder, and the prevalence of pain is high in depressed patients. So if there is a relationship, we will see. The suicidal ideations were reported in patients with a chronic pain higher than the general population. And it was related to the pain severity and the comorbidity with depression, like pain and depression. And we see that the number of, or the percentage of the suicidal ideation reached to 20%, the actual thoughts about 13%, and the suicidal attempts maybe 5% in patients with the chronic pain patients. So suicidal ideations even is major issue in a chronic pain patient. Even they try to find the risk factors for suicide. We know that the general risk factor for suicide, like family history of suicide or previous suicide attempts and so on, all the psychiatrists know the general risk factor for depression. But do you know that even depression, pain by itself, could be a risk factor for suicides? If this pain is catastrophizing, if there is a disability, if there is a sleep disturbance, if there is avoidance or problem-solving deficit, so there is a problem. I was astonished even in this study, like back pain and fibromyalgia and migraine, this combination could be a risk factor for suicide. I think this is a major issue. Like we should search for pain in our psychiatric patient, and the GP or the internal medicine, they should search for the depression and suicidal risk in their patient. So we need to involve the psychiatry and the psychiatric aspect and how they can diagnose. And the most important issue in my presentation, to explain to them, to the GP and the internal medicine or the orthopedics, that when the patient have a depression and they have pain, this is not in their mind. This is not related to the stress even of the disease. No, we will see later on, there is a biologically changing happening in the brain. And this gave us the spectrum of what we call functional somatic syndrome. For example, you know the fibromyalgia. Fibromyalgia is an example for someone who have chronic pain and they have other disorders or other symptoms similar more or less to depression. We'll see later on. Stell defined this functional somatic syndrome as a spectrum from the mood and an anxiety disorder. In one side of the spectrum, there is a mood and an anxiety disorder. And in the other side of the spectrum, there is the pain and the headache and irritable bowel and the fibromyalgia. All these patients, they have symptoms and there is no organic cause. And we'll see later, like example of fibromyalgia, all these patients who have fibromyalgia, irritable bowel, or headache, they have manifestation of depression more or less and an anxiety more or less. And the mixed features in them is fatigue, sleep disturbance, and cognitive impairment. We'll see this in this diagram. We'll see these disorders. I consider them as a neuropsychophysiological disorder, chronic fatigue patients. Chronic fatigue, they don't have anything. If you do all the investigation, you will not find anything. You will not find abnormality. you will have a lot of patient come with a lot of investigations, a lot of imaging. You will not find anything. Irritable bowel syndrome, tension type headache, even migraine, temporomandibular joint disturbance or pain. Temporomandibular joint pain or disorder, usually the patient are coming like trigeminal neuralgia and feeling of severe pain around the joint. And if you do MRI, you will not find anything. And we try a lot of therapy for them, analgesic and so on. And the response is more or less not equal. Restless leg syndrome and periodic leg movement, primary dysmenorrhea. So all these disorders and female urethral disorders, syndromes. So all of these disorders, they are disorder characterized by pain and somatic manifestations. And actually, they have nothing. They have no organic change. If you do biopsy, you will not find anything. If you do investigation, you will not find anything. The research attribute all of this disorder to what we call central sensitization. And we'll see what's the meaning of central sensitization later on. Central sensitization means all the body is responding in hyper-excitable state. From the peripheral nerve, the peripheral receptors, to the peripheral nerve, to the dorsal root ganglia, to the spinal cord, and up to even to the brain. All these organs are hyper-excitable and irritable and receiving the small, non-painful elements as highly painful. And you don't find anything in the structural abnormality you can treat. For example, you know the clinical features of fibromyalgia, widespread pain, and the patient describes it as so and so and so. But look to the other symptoms, which is common and highly common in patients with fibromyalgia. Cognitive impairment, sleep disturbance, mood disturbance, morning stiffness and tenderness. I will consider morning stiffness in patients with fibromyalgia if they are negative from rheumatoid arthritis, as you know, because they have a morning stiffness. And I found the orthopedics or the patient or the rheumatologist, they say, okay, this is a seronegative rheumatoid. What's the difference between fibromyalgia and seronegative rheumatoid if you don't find a rheumatoid factors or rheumatoid factor positive? Patients with fibromyalgia is more or less similar to patients with depression. Cognitive impairment, sleep disturbance, and fatigue is common in depression. Morning stiffness is like depression, like we are talking about the urinary variation of depression. So maybe fibromyalgia could be a spectrum from the depression like Stahl have considered. If this is fibromyalgia is musculoskeletal disorder, it is a mental disorder and they have nothing, it's inflammatory and rheumatological disorder, or it's an illness of the central nervous system, which I try to present my presentation today. All of these disorders and the depression are illness in the central nervous system. Fibromyalgia and depression, they common in the families. And they can present in, and the odd ratio is 2%, like the increased lifetime and family history of mood disorder in fibromyalgia versus rheumatoid. So fibromyalgia patients, they have an odd ratio of 2 if increasing the lifetime or the family history of mood disorders. And fibromyalgia can co-aggregate with major depression in family. Maybe they have genetic predispositions. They have the similar sleep disturbance. My subspecialty was in the sleep. And we have a various diagnostic criteria for major depression in sleep in the polysomnography, which is a shortened REM latency and increased REM durations and REM come early. And with antidepressants, the REM durations is decreased. And this similar sleep architecture abnormality, which happened is depression, we see it also in fibromyalgia. Like, it seemed like there is a cardinal features and biological similarity between the sleep of fibromyalgic patient and the sleep of depression. And they have similar cognitive disturbance. They have an autonomic abnormality. There is a lot of imaging study. There was a study about fibromyalgia which showed atrophy on the area of the brain in the hippocampus, which is, we usually consider it as a part of the diagnostic criteria for depression, like atrophy of the hippocampus is a diagnostic for depression. This has happened also in fibromyalgia. So there is a neuroendocrinal studies, imaging studies, connect both disorders from the biological point of view. So what's happening? What are the relations between these disorders and the depression? Now we will discuss the biology of depression. We know, all the psychiatrists, even the junior psychiatrists, know this stuff. They know that the norepinephrine is responsible for the alertness and concentrations. The dopamine is responsible for the pleasure. The serotonin is responsible for the optionality and the anxiety and the irritability. Where is the somatized? Where is headache here? Where is the back pain? Where is the there is part between the serotonin and norepinephrine, like the appetite and sex. But where is the other stuff? Where is the other physical symptoms? This is not shown in this presentation, in this slide. If we look to this slide, we see that there is similar dysregulation in the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis between depression and anxiety. Again, in the left side of the slide, we know that the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis in acute stress, the corticotropin releasing factor is released, and when it's released, it's stimulating the release of adrenocorticotropic hormone from the pituitary, and the adrenocorticotropic hormone stimulate the release of cortisol from the adrenal gland, and the cortisol come back and prevent itself the release of itself by negative feedback mechanism through the glucocorticoid receptors in the hippocampus and in the hypothalamus. So what's happening in chronic stress? You lost this negative feedback mechanism because of the atrophy which happened in the hippocampal hypothalamic glucocorticoid receptors, and there is continuous release of the cortisol, and this would result into the depression and what we know the planted adrenocorticotropic hormone stimulations or the planted cortisol response. The same happened in pain, chronic pain disorders. And you will see later in this slide, this is the same slide like before, but with different painting. But I would like to present how the serotonin and norepinephrine is involved in the negative feedback mechanism. So the negative feedback mechanism, if it will work right, you need norepinephrine and serotonin to be involved in this negative feedback mechanism, either directly or through the GABAergic interneurons. So if that's what's happening when we give a patient SNRI, for example, it will resort the glucocorticoids negative feedback inhibition on itself and returning the planting hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis response into its normal state. So in the negative feedback mechanism of depression, norepinephrine and serotonin is important to correct the abnormality of the negative feedback mechanism which happened in chronic depression. So what's happening in pain? This slide show what's normal happen if you injury or trauma or any of your receptors. You know, you have nociceptors all over our body, in the skin, in the bones, in our heart, in the GIT. We all have, we all know that the nociceptors is present all over our body in every organs where the organ can feel pain. You know what's the two organs or the two parts of our body which don't have the nociceptors? The hair and nail. And that's why you don't feel pain while you are cutting your hair, or you have no pain when you are cutting your nails. Other than the hair and nail, all your body contain these receptors. When this receptor is injured by trauma or by repeated injury, or maybe by unknown reason, there is stimulation of the prostaglandin and the stimulations of arachidonic cascades and leukotrienes and the inflammatory markers in the nociceptor's terminal, and then the impulse is transmitted to the dorsal root ganglia and going up into the spinal cord and finally into the brain. We all know that the brain receives the pain in where? You all know the brain receives the pain in the thalamus. We all know the thalamus is the sensation of pain. Yes, in the thalamus you sense pain. But in other higher structural cortical lesion, you appreciate pain, cognitive appreciation of pain. The somatic associations, which the somatic reactions which happen in the presence of pain, the cognitive modulations, the memory information of the pain happen in other organs or other parts of the brain in higher cortical area. This prefrontal cortex and orbitofrontal cortex and very general anterior cingulate gyrus, you know, this area is also responsible for depression. So the final relay of the pain transmission is not in the thalamus. The thalamus is only to feel the pain, but to make a memory for such pain, to the psychological component of the pain, the cognitive appraisal of the pain. So if I have a pain, I will remember when it's happened and how much it's affecting my life, my feeling when I am I have this pain. The somatic reactions happen in other cortical, higher cortical area other than the thalamus, and this higher cortical area is responsible for the development of is the same like this area is responsible for development of depression. And what's happening when the brain receives the pain? The pain normally, under the normal circumstances, it sends the descending inhibitory impulse to dumping the pain perception at the receptor level. And you know which neurotransmitter is involved in these descending inhibitory pathways? Norepinephrine and serotonin and dopamine. Excuse me, this is the neurotransmitters of depression. So when you're receiving pain or you have any damage in your organ, your brain receives the pain and sends its analgesic effect, either through the opioids, you know, the endorphin and enkephalin, and through the descending inhibitory impulse from the upper brain area through the norepinephrine and serotonin. So norepinephrine and serotonin, as we saw before, is responsible for controlling the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis in depression, and is normally responsible for controlling of the pain perception in chronic pain patients. And this descending tract even is different according to the serotonin receptor, for example. You know that the 5-HT3 receptors, which is usually antagonized by one of the famous antidepressants, which is mirtazapine. You know, this receptor, 5-HT3, is stimulating the pain. So if you block this 5-HT3 by mirtazapine, for example, you can control pain. And so, mirtazapine is working by its antihistaminic effect in a small dose gave us to sedate the patients, like 15 milligram will be enough. But if you increase the dose to 30 or even 45 milligram, you will involve this serotonin and the blockage of the 5-HT3, and this will treat two things, the pain and the GIT abnormality, and that's why mirtazapine can increase appetites and improve even the SNRI or SSRI-induced GIT abnormality. So this by acting, this action is through the blockage of 5-HT3. Norepinephrine descending pathway can be stimulated by clonidine. And that's why we use clonidine for the treatment of hyper-excitable states which happen in addicted patients. If I return back to the slides which showed irritable bowel syndrome and systemic hypersensitizations or central hypersensitizations or central sensitization, I should include patients who are withdrawn from opioid, because we see these patients who are highly painful in everything. Everything can hurt them. They usually come to us even during the detoxification. I have a lot of back pain. Please, my doctor, just relieve the pain. And that's why, because the only thing we can do in this time, either we give mirtazapine and they sleep well, or sometimes we give them clonidine what the clonidine do? It improves the norepinephrine descending pathway or decrease the activity of the norepinephrine descending pathway. So the balance between the serotonin and norepinephrine is important for controlling of the pain through the descending tracts and also the opioid inhibitory system coming with that. So what's the central sensitization in general? It's high activity from bottom up from bottom up system. So the nociceptive transmission is hyperactive from the peripheral organs to the brain, is hyper excitable, and change in the down regulations, either inhibitory or facilitatory, in the top down inhibitory pathway, particularly descending pathway, opioids or norepinephrine and serotonin. So when all these disorders, which we mentioned, like fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue and this stuff, and patients with a chronic pain disorder, their organ are hypersensitized from the periphery, and their brain inhibitory descending pathway, serotonergic, norepinephrine, and dopaminergic pathway, serotonergic, and particularly serotonergic and norepinephrine pathway, descending pathway, are inhibited. So what we need to dump in the hyper-excitable states from the periphery and increase the inhibitory descending pathway from the brain through stimulating the serotonin and norepinephrine. In general, to wrap up all what mentions, in chronic case, when the pain become chronic and when the central sensitizations happen, pain does not end, stress does not end, hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis are overdriven, proliferation of the peripheral inflammatory markers, heightened pain response, inhibition of the descending cortical modulation, which is the nociceptive breaking, and depletion of catecholamines, adrenaline, and serotonin, and all will end finally into a chronic pain and a depressive behavior and depressive mood. So I hope you are with me and I did not lose your attention. So what we'll do? Why we are asking about all of this issue? Why we are discussing it? Now, everyone who is working with us now understand that in pain and depression and in chronic and in central sensitization, these persons or this patient, they are not faking the symptoms, and they are not having such this pain just in their mind. No, they have abnormality in all this pathway, and we should correct them. And this is like a summary for what we mentioned. From the peripheral sensitization, prostaglandin sodium become high, but sodium channels is open, neurokinins and inflammatory marker are higher, glutamate is high, and that's because it's inflammatory process, and we all know that the glutamate is hyper-excited in the inflammatory cases or in stress and the chronic stress, and it's one of the cause of inhibition of the brain-derived neurotrophic factor, as we will see later on. And the calcium influx is higher, the prostaglandin and substance P is high, and the norepinephrine serotonin pathway, descending inhibitory pathway, is diminished from the brain. So how we can treat this? We can treat all of this by these therapies. From the periphery, we can treat with the anticonvulsants. We know that the anticonvulsant, like pregabalin and gabapentin and even carbamazepine, can treat peripheral pain, like peripheral neuropathy, for example. I found, like in this slide, that tricyclic antidepressant, it's even work in the periphery. You know why? Because the tricyclic antidepressant have a sodium channel blocker activity. And that's why triptizole or other, particularly triptizole, but other tricyclic antidepressant can work. Like, it can treat the pain even from the periphery. And that's why we can treat the diabetic neuropathy and the peripheral pain by tricyclic antidepressant. And of course, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory can be used. You know that when you use non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, it prevents arachidonic cascades and prevents prostaglandin synthesis and so on. And that's why the problem to receive patients or to give a patient who are depressed and have a pain, like tricyclic antidepressant, anticonvulsant, non-steroidal, to treat the pain from the periphery and the peripheral sensitization. And we can treat the central sensitizations by NMDA receptor antagonists, like memantine, for example, and the ketamine. We will see later about the future therapy for pain and the future therapy for depression, like ketamine infusion. And we can treat the descending or can improve the descending modulation of pain by either, again, by anticonvulsants, by opioid maybe, but we have a problem with the opioids because of the addiction, and by SNRI or tricyclic antidepressants, which have a serotonergic noradrenergic activity. So maybe we should treat somatic depressed patients different from other type of depression. You know, in the algorithm for depression, the first drug in almost of every algorithm is SSRI. But if a patient who is somatizing, SSRI will not be of benefit. We need to improve either by tricyclic or by SNRI, by or by combinations of these hyper-excitable states by stimulation from the impulse from inside, from downstairs, from down up, which is the peripheral sensitization, and by improving the noradrenergic, serotonergic descending modulation of pain from up down. For example, anticonvulsants, we know that pregabalin and gabapentin. One of the most marvelous drugs was used in the last few years was pregabalin in pain and chronic pain patients. Even in patients with opioid addictions, we try to improve them or treat the withdrawal symptoms. Pregabalin was one of marvelous drugs, but we have a lot of side effects, we know, and we know that it's become a controlled drugs, so it cannot be prescribed even with prescriptions with the physicians and just for 1 week or something. So, but it's approved for chronic pain and multiple neuropathic pain disorders. And it actually improved the sleep and increased the slow wave sleep in the expense of REM sleep. And that's why patients who used to get pregabalin, and that's what happened in our country, in Egypt, a lot of addicts who in the tramadol, for example, become withdrawn from the market, pregabalin was their choice instead of going even to opioid or heroin, because the patients, they feel good, they sleep well, and they actually their depression is improved. And pregabalin, it improves or it enhances slow wave sleep on the expense of REM sleep. As we mentioned, that one of the diagnostic marker of the sleep architecture in depression is increase in REM. So if you increase the slow wave sleep replacing the slow wave sleep instead of the REM, the patient is improving in regard of the depression. And we see a lot of patients, even with depression, was improving with pregabalin. We now have a pregabalin, gabapentin, which is more or less similar to pregabalin in the mechanism of action, but it has a problem in the side effect, maybe higher than pregabalin. And this is the mechanism how pregabalin and gabapentin it work. It prevents the calcium channel in different, the transmission of calcium channels or opening of the calcium channel in the dorsal root ganglia. And so it prevents the calcium influx and decreasing the hyperexcitability state and decreasing the pain sensitivity. And that's why the patients who with the withdrawn from opioids or even chronic pain patient was improving a lot with pregabalin. But we have a problem with Neurontin and Lyrica, or pregabalin and gabapentin, that this study showed that it prevents synaptogenesis. Like, it's not only because it's addictive properties, but also it have a problem that it's attached to a receptors which is responsible for the synaptogenesis. So the problem that patients who are taking Neurontin or Lyrica will have a problem in the synaptogenesis and in the formations of new cells and new synapses. So what's better than pregabalin? What's better than gabapentin? I think that only the junior psychiatrists may not know the term of number need to treat. I will mention it. The statistical term of number need to treat, which means how many patients you need to treat with these drugs to gave one response over the placebo. Like in SSRI, in a chronic pain or painful neuropathy, for example, you need to treat about 6 patients to improve 1 patient more than the placebo. So if the number need to treat is low, this means it is higher efficacy. You see that the SNRI and the tricyclic antidepressants, which have post-serotonergic and noradrenergic mechanism, they have a higher number than the smaller number need to treat than even gabapentin, and actually a lot lower than SSRI. SSRI, actually, it can aggravate the pain. And that's why one of the major side effects of the SSRI is headache and GIT abnormality. It does not treat the pain. While SNRI can treat the pain, and particularly chronic painful condition like painful neuropathy. In this meta-analysis, at the comparative tricyclic and SSRI, tricyclic about 80% give a positive result, and SSRI about 35% of the studies only give a positive result, which means treatment of chronic pain, we should apply the tricyclic or SNRI instead of using SSRI. So in algorithm, we should consider patients who have somatizing disorder is different from who have no somatizing disorder. And if they have somatizing, we cannot start with the SSRI. Maybe we need to start with the SNRI. We know the most of the SSRI, we know SNRI, you know, we know the difference between duloxetine and milnacipram and venlafaxine and desvenlafaxine. And this is a small table. I think all of you know what the difference between them. But the only difference which I would like to consider is the difference in its pharmacological comparison between both. The main three, milnacipram, duloxetine, and venlafaxine, the main serotonergic noradrenergic reuptake inhibitor. Venlafaxine have a multiple metabolites, while duloxetine and milnacipram have no metabolites. And venlafaxine, you know that this venlafaxine is its metabolites, active metabolites. The metabolism is mainly hepatic in venlafaxine, while duloxetine actually hepatic and partially hepatic and partially renal, and milnacipram is minimally hepatic. And so milnacipram have the least drug-drug interactions. Duloxetine is half-half, and venlafaxine have high drug-drug interactions because it work according to the cytochrome B450, because it's all metabolism is hepatic. This is the most important point, that the serotonergic to the noradrenergic properties of each drug is different. Like the venlafaxine, the serotonergic activity is 30%, 30-1 to the noradrenergic activity, which means venlafaxine is actually as SSRI with minimal noradrenergic activity. And you need to escalate the dose from 75 to 150 to 225, maybe to 300, to obtain this part noradrenergic activity. And that's why venlafaxine, although it's highly effective in depression, it works in pain, but it works in a higher concentrations. Maybe these concentrations you are carrying a lot of side effects, including the hypertension and drug-drug interactions and the GIT abnormality. Duloxetine and milnacipram work simultaneously as noradrenergic and serotonergic from the first dose, with a different comparison, 10-1 in case of duloxetine and serotonin to norepinephrine, and 1-1 in milnacipram. A lot of persons or someone will say, okay, milnacipram will be perfect, actually, because it gives us actually serotonergic equal to the noradrenergic. This is yes. It's perfect for pain. And the FDA approved drugs for fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome. In chronic pain conditions, you need serotonergic, noradrenergic balance. You need 1-1. But in depression, you know, it did not have an FDA approval. One of the like isomer of it, of the milnacipram, which have the FDA approval for depression. Because if the patient have depression, actually you need a higher level of serotonin than the norepinephrine. That's why duloxetine will be one of the best choice in case of combination between depression and chronic painful situation, or depression and somatizations. This is like the algorithm you can use, like depression and pain, you can use SNRI and tricyclic. It's non-logic to use SSRI. Depression and pain and anxiety, duloxetine and venlafaxine will be the same. Depression and pain and cognitive, vortuxetine will be the cognitive complaint. Vortuxetine, you know that it have an impairment or improvement of the cognitive enhancer because it work in 5-HT7 and 6, and it increase the level of glutamate. Maybe if you have a sleep disturbance, aiding pregabalin or gabapentin will be effective. If you have a fatigue, maybe bupropion or modafinil is an effective aiding agent for the SNRI you are using for combination of pain and depression. This is like a summary for the medication we can use, like tricyclic and SNRI. Mirtazapine, we mentioned that it works as a 5-HT3 blocker. Sodium channel blocker. Like I have no problem if a patient come to me who is actually having a depression to prescribe them SNRI to improve the descending inhibitory pathway coming from the brain, and prescribe even a small dose of tricyclic like triptazole or something to improve the, but in a small dose, not in a big dose, because I don't need its SNRI property. I need its sodium channel blocker activity, or maybe giving anticonvulsant, and a lot of anticonvulsants can use. Clonidine and lamotrigine has a named antagonist. Amantadine and memantine is named the antagonist. So you can use a combination. Even you can use a corticosteroids in a patient to dump in these hyper excitable states, which happen in the peripheral sensitizations, and with the SNRI to improve the descending inhibitory impulse, which coming from the brain to dump in the hyper excitable state from up. A lot of caution we should consider, like non-steroidal. You know that it can increase the GIT bleeding, and I see a lot of patients who are receiving SNRI or SSRI and receiving non-steroidal, they have gastritis. Tramadol is one of the, I think they have, it has an SNRI and opioid agonist effect, but if you use it with the SNRI, you can increase the possibility of serotonin syndrome. Tricyclic, when you are using with gabapentin, you have a lot of psychomotor impairment and CNS depression, and we see a lot of patients going into confusion from this combination. So you should take care of these drug-drug interactions. We cannot mention only that the drug is effective. We know that the psychotherapy is effective. We know that the cognitive behavioral therapy and mindfulness-based therapy is effective for depressions, and we cannot ignore that. But I just present these slides to give a point about exercise. Exercise is very important. We know, like, we have a problem now of exercising because of the limited time, because of the coronavirus and a lot of stuff. But exercise is very important for depression and for chronic pain condition. But you should know something, that in exercise is responsible for not increasing the serotonin. It's just increasing the norepinephrine. And that's why in this study, it showed that when you are doing a physical exercise or asking the patient to doing a physical activity, it's very important that this exercise much better response if the patient is receiving noradrenergic dopaminergic medications. Like if this will give a reciprocal positive relationship between the noradrenergic dopaminergic increase and the exercise. SSRI will not give this advantage. Like if you are giving or asking a depressed patient to do exercise, and you're asking two depressed patients, what with the SSRI and what with the SNRI or with the dopaminergic agent, the patients who are receiving noradrenergic dopaminergic facilitation will have much improvement for the depression and physical symptoms if they are using physical exercise. Finally, we will go to the future therapy. What's the future therapy we are going on? The first future therapy, we know the modafinil. Modafinil is, to me, it will improve the alertness, tiredness, and fatigue, which is one of the symptoms very common with the SSRI and with the even with the SNRI. Sometimes, even we the maximum dose of the drugs, you cannot control the fatigue, and the patient usually complain of fatigue. Modafinil, you can use it as adjuvant therapy, and because modafinil is working in improvement or increasing almost all of the neurotransmitter of the brain. All the stimulant neurotransmitter. It can stimulate glutamates and dopamine and serotonin, even acetylcholine, histamine, norepinephrine, and decrease the GABA, which is inhibitory neurotransmitter. And this means by modafinil, you can aid the serotonergic, noradrenergic effect and the stimulating effect for patients who are continuous or continuing to having fatigue and lethargy and sleepiness with the SSRI or the SNRI. And there is a big difference between modafinil and methylphenidates and atomoxetine, both acting as increasing the norepinephrine. But in case of methylphenidates or atomoxetine, they found that it gave stimulated vigilance, like you are awake and you are hyperactive, but you are worried, you are highly vigilant, you are frightened. So it gave an anxiety. So while modafinil is the best, because also on alpha adrenergic receptor, so it increases the norepinephrine and it increases acetylcholine and other neurotransmitter, as we mentioned, and serotonin. So it gave us wakefulness with calmness. So the cognition is improve, the creativity and the attentions, all of them is alerting or increased, and so the patient is alerting and still calm, not anxious like methylphenidate or etomuxetine. And this is again the same, like it improves the sleepiness and improves the alertness. And even there was studies about modafinil that it improved the alertness in normal people, not only in depressed patients or in patients with narcolepsy. That's the disease which has been FDA approved for modafinil. And this is a lot of study for improving the alertness and sleepiness in depression and in bipolar, even concomitant depression in bipolar depression. So modafinil may have a role in managing fatigue and sleepiness in patients with depression. The other drugs which have a glory at this time is ketamine. My professor, Dr. Afaf Hamed, is a professor of psychiatry in Shams University. She is my professor, and I taught a lot of, I know a lot of psychiatry from her. She have a attacking me from talking about ketamine and cannabinoids even, because she say it's not FDA approved ketamine. Yes, it's not FDA approved yet, although there is ketamine which is approved as a nasal spray in the and it have a very short pass in the FDA to have approval for depression. Ketamine, it's working in as a glutamate named the antagonist. Again, a lot of my students ask me, okay, we need glutamate or we don't need glutamate in depression? We need it in a modest state, because the glutamate is responsible for the formations of the impulse and the formation of the memory and consolidation of the memory and formation of alertness. And it's responsible for transcriptions of nuclear factors which protect the cells. But excess glutamate is toxic. So if you increase the glutamate, this means you have a toxic effect, and that's why NMDA antagonist is important, like memantine. But ketamine, it blocks the NMDA receptors, but it does not block it on the glutamate receptor. See the mechanism in depression. Normally in depression, glutamate is diminished, and that's why the formations of the second messenger system and the formation of the brain-derived neurotrophic factors is diminished, and so the protein synthesis and synaptic modulation and synaptogenesis is prevented in stress and major depression. So when the glutamate increase with the frequent depression and stress, glutamate start to cause inhibition by itself, so it decreases the synaptogenesis and protein formations. So what's the mechanism ketamine do? It works in the NMDA receptor on the GABA receptors, in the NMDA receptor on the GABA interneurons. So what's happening? So it blocks the GABAminergic interneurons, and that's why it allows a rush of glutamate coming from the presynaptic neurons to the postsynaptic neurons to stimulate the release of the brain-derived neurotrophic factors and improve the synaptic and protein synthesis and synaptogenesis. So it's very important to know that ketamine can improve the depression just temporarily. You use it only in very resistant cases with the usual drugs we are using, like SSRI or SNRI. We just need a gush of glutamate or a burst of glutamate to push the neurogenesis and brain-derived neurotrophic factors out or up for a while, so the antidepressant can work much better. So we can use ketamine just for short periods, for short period of time, for resistant cases, and only to improve the stress and improve the synaptogenesis and the brain-derived neurotrophic factor. But you cannot use ketamine as a continuous antidepressant. It's just in cases who have a severe depression and does not respond to any antidepressant. So we can use it either, as we mentioned, by infusions or like ketamine, which is approved by the FDA as a nasal spray. And this is the studies which show that the improvement from depression happened with the single dose, with the single dose of ketamine. From the first single dose of ketamine, almost of the depressions can improve much better than the placebo, and the difference was highly significant. And you see, even within minutes, and within the first day, and the second day, and 7 day, and these continuations happen only for the 7 day. And lastly, you should use the SNRI or the SSRI you are using. Just you push the patient out from the severe depression with the ketamine infusion. And again, happen in resistant bipolar depression. With the same study have been done for resistant bipolar depression, and it gave the same response within minutes or days. It improved the depression much better than the placebo, and that's why you can use it just to make a burst of glutamate to reduce brain derived neurotrophic factors in high dose. And this is the FDA approval for the Spartiva, Spartavita, which is esketamine, because it found that it's higher affinity, it's higher than the ketamine by itself, and this S ketamine, the S isomer is higher in affinity for the NMDA receptors. So ketamine, as it worked for depression, it worked for pain, and because it's again it has affinity to the serotonergic and noradrenergic transporters. So ketamine could be able to activate the descending inhibitory pathway. So in patients who have a chronic pain and depression, maybe ketamine will be a good choice later on. And this is one of the slides which shows that the ketamine is used for chronic pain cases in patients with chronic fatigue or complex regional pain syndromes or fibromyalgia or trigeminal neuralgia. And so it can use it to compete the pain. So it's one of the newer drugs which you can use in for therapy of severe depressed patients who have high somatization. So you can treat by ketamine, it's the pain and the depression at the same time. And this is a lot of study about the effect of ketamine, the controlled trials for different pain disorders like fibromyalgia, phantom limb, and post-herpetic neuralgia, and so on. The other or the last issue is cannabinoid. Again, when I present this presentation before in front of my professor, Mustafa Shaheen, he said, you cannot speak about cannabinoid. I never ask to legalize cannabis, but we should know what's happening in the world, in the studies and in the research. Synthetic cannabinoids have the efficacy that it works as on the cannabinoid receptors without giving the euphoric effect of the tetrahydrocannabinoid. So maybe this is in the future's plans or in the future year in resistance cases, as we find that ketamine has been approved, the esketamine has been approved as a nasal spray. Maybe at the time we'll find that synthetic cannabinoids could be effective. And why is cannabinoid? Because cannabinoid receptor have a very specific features. Features which we said it's sensitized on demand. Endocannabinoids, which is the normal ligand or the internal ligand of cannabinoid receptors, it's a synthetic or it's sensitized on demand when the synapse is activated. And we have two cannabinoid receptors, cannabinoid 1 and cannabinoid 2. Cannabinoid 2 receptor is have anti-inflammatory effect, so it's work as immunomodulation. And cannabinoid 1 is present all over our body, or all over the brain area, which is responsible for transmission of pain on the cortex, on the basal ganglia, on the cerebellum, in the hippocampus, in the spinal cord, and in the peripheral nerves, and even on the skin and the GIT. Cannabinoid receptor? Yes. Cannabinoid receptor is present all over our pain reception or perception area. So this is important that the cannabinoid receptor will work, and how the cannabinoid receptor it works. When it works by, it releases endocannabinoids, it releases on demand. When the synapse is activated, the endocannabinoid is released from the postsynaptic neurons and working on the cannabinoid receptor in the presynaptic neurons to dump in the release of the neurotransmitters, which is active or hyperactive like glutamate synapse or GABAminergic synapses. And also the endocannabinoids have a serotonergic-like activity. And so in conclusions, somatizations, major depression disorder with somatizations, fibromyalgia, and other disorder associated with heightened pain response should be categorized as a special entity that requires special treatment regimen. That means we cannot use SSRI in these patients, for example. And we may use combination which is not applicable in other patients with depression. Pathogenesis of such disorder is related to upregulation of the peripheral nociceptive sensation and downregulation of the central inhibitory serotonergic and noradrenergic mechanisms. Treatment from below and from above can be an effective as a combined therapy with SNRI with anticonvulsant, for example, and novel therapeutic option like ketamine, cannabinoid agonist, memantine may be a promising options for management of somatizations from below and from above simultaneously. And thank you. And I am so sorry for having a long time with you. Thank you so much. Yes.
Thanks, Professor Osama, for the fruitful sessions. It was really informative with a lot of knowledge. As some participants need to share your presentation on later time.
it's my pleasure. It's my honor to do that.
Thanks. But I'd like to refer all participants to fill a survey about the meeting below in the orange block beside the screen in the banner to receive event certificate signed by the Egyptian Psychiatric Association. Now we would refer the questions to Professor Dr. Osama. We have some questions. First. There is a question about why is the prevalence of somatized depression between developing and the developed countries? Is there any relation about diet, lifestyles, and so?
Yes, in countries with lower socioeconomic class or lower education, there is a problem for understanding that the depression is a disease. They consider it as like bad thing or you are weak person. Like if a illiterate patient and say, I am depressed, none of the family members will accept that or will accept that as an issue. Sometimes they go to the religious people for religious healer, for example, or traditional healers. So usually the presentations will become more accepted for the patients who are illiterates or lower socioeconomic class and persons in environments which does not accept the psychological issue as an important point to consider. And that's why, you know, what's happening in countries, in the developing country from the psychiatrist, if you find, I was a young student and I want to go to a psychiatrist, my father was a surgeon, and they say, okay, what you will do in psychiatry? There is nothing to do. Psychiatry is not a branch in medicine. A lot of physicians even don't consider psychiatry as an important part in developing country. While in already higher socioeconomic class and higher developed countries, the issue of psychiatry and the issue of depression and the issue of anxiety has been brought to the public in a wide base, and it was brought in the mind of the populations, so they accept that it's a disease. It accept that it's not a part of weakness or low religious aspect or part of deficit in you if you are depressed or anxious or panic. So I think this is related to the expression, and again, it's related to the stress. like, but I think the stress even in the developing country will be higher than the developed country. But the main issue that how the patient or the person transmit this stress, either it transmit it into either physical symptoms or transmit it into a psychological symptom. This is based on the educations and the standard of living and even the public awareness.
Thanks, doctor. We have another question. Dr. Ahmed asks you, do SSRIs increase risk of only GIT bleeding or also per vagina and the other bleeding?
Yes, SSRI, it have the platelets, they have a serotonin receptors. And SSRI, when it work, it disturb the adhesions of the platelets to each other. And that's why it can carry a risk for any bleeding, vaginal bleeding, menstrual irregularities. It carries a risk, of course, of GIT bleeding. And even it carries the risk of bleeding in a stroke. Like we find a lot of patients, we've given them stroke patient. Like, for example, we gave clopidogrel and aspirin. If we combine with SSRI, there is a higher risk, and there is a higher risk even in hemorrhagic stroke or hemorrhagic transformation of stroke. So SSRI, because it's affect not on the GIT mucosa, it's affecting on the platelets adhesion, and so it increases the bleeding tendency from different places.
Thanks, doctor. We have another question from Dr. Shaima. Why is depression more prevalent in women than in men? It's an ordinary question.
Only thing you can carry it is for women. We carry the ischemic heart and stroke. She is like, okay. But you know, the problem in women, there is a lot of theory about that. One of them is hormonal theory. The women, they are susceptible for hormonal change through its menstrual cycles. And even through her life up to the menopause, they are susceptible for the fluctuations of the hormones. And you know that the estrogen have a calming effect, and so this fluctuation could be susceptible for them or make them more susceptible for depressions or fluctuations of mood or irritable mood. And there is in DSM-5, there is a specific entity of premenstrual dysphoric disorder or premenstrual tensions and so on. So the first is hormonal. The second is, again, cultural. Maybe it's accepted for a man to express his emotions freely, like, although the woman, maybe they have some limitation for the expression of emotions. I say to my students, because I receive this question from my students a lot, usually if a man like a woman, he can ask her for marriage, but if a woman like a man, she cannot ask him for a marriage. Like, she cannot go and take him. So usually they have limitation in the expression of their emotions. The other issue is again the response for the metabolism of the drugs may be different from woman to man. Like, we see it particularly in the antipsychotic, like in schizophrenia, when the antidepressant in the woman, they are or they are equally involved like men, but when the man having schizophrenia, it become more severe. So usually there is difference in the expression of the emotions, the hormonal aspect, the stress they are facing is different. And the responsibility of the woman, you know, the man from the psychological point of view is target. Like, I'm doing this presentation, I lost any contact with the world, I cannot speak with my women, I cannot speak with my wife, or I cannot speak with my friends. Like, although the woman can do a lot of things and she is responsible for doing a lot of things at the same time, raising a child, and she's working hard, and she has a lot of the same stress we are facing. So there is a lot of explanatory models explaining the higher risk for depression in women than men.
Thanks, doctor. Another question about, is there any possibility for the future to see a formulation means drug contains ketamine in an oral form or just in intranasal and infusion?
They tried ketamine as an oral, but it has a very, let's say it has an impairment absorption. Or its absorption is not, it is hierarchic in or it's not easy from the GIT, or it's not smooth. So the oral applications have been tried a lot before, even they tried the infusion, and they don't find it effective. And because, you know, that ketamine, the first thing we do the first indication as anesthetic agent. So because it's used as anesthetic agents, the infusion was available when they tried in depression and the chronic pain. And we usually give it in a small dose, low than the anesthetic dose, like 0.5 milligram per kg. And although the anesthetic dose is 3 to 5 milligram per kg. And in this small dose, it gave a patient like in a dissociative state between sleep and wakefulness. Like what we are doing when we are doing a ketamine infusion is that to increase the dose gradually, drop by drop, till the patient going into a dissociative state. The psychiatrist will understand what I mean by this dissociative state. Like in between wakefulness and sleep. If they go to sleep, it become an anesthetic, and it can cause even laryngeal spasm, and the patient may need intubation. And if the patient is awake, he will not have the effective dissociative state, which is effective in treatment of depression. So you cannot manipulate these doses in the oral form. So you need the infusion. The final nasal spray molecule, which has been approved because of the very rapid absorption area, which will happen from the nasal mucosa, and very rapid rush of ketamine, which go to the circulations and causing rapid rush of glutamate and brain-derived neurotrophic factor. And that's the effective therapy which we need.
I think the previous question is related to the high cost of this formula.
Of course, it's still high. And even the company which is created it, they did not launch it for regular use. It's just used for severe cases who are not responding to the NRI and combinations and all the augmenting agents. And even we use it for patients who are not responding for ST, or instead of the ST in patients who have a fracture or fixations, we cannot use the ST for them.
Thanks, doctor. We have a question about what is the recommendation of duration of modafinil use? Another question: does vorituxin has role in pain management in depression?
Yes, the same mechanism like mirtazapine working in 5-HT3. Mirtazapine working in 5-HT3 will result into increase the dose of or increase the release of norepinephrine and serotonin. And that's why mirtazapine in a small dose is sedating. In higher dose, like 45 milligram, is not sedating. Maybe if you increase the dose above 30 milligram, the patient will say to you, now I am more alert, like at 45 milligram. And vorituxin work with the same mechanism. It works as a noradrenergic and serotonergic mechanism, and it gave a gush of glutamate and dopaminergic agents, and it increased even the dopamine. So, and increased acetylcholine. So vorituxin can be alerting, and so you cannot use it, or almost you cannot use it in night. Some patients, they have maybe different response, but almost I use it in the morning, and it gave a lot of alertness and a lot of wakefulness. And because it have a double actions of serotonergic, noradrenergic mechanism, you can use it for the treatment of depression with somatization, or even for pain, and have been tried for pain also. As regard the first questions about modafinil, there is no guidelines about the use of these combinations with antidepressant. We can use it till the patient have a satisfactory response, and we use the antidepressants if it's the first attack for 6 months or 1 year, if it's two attacks for 2 years or 5 years, and if it's more than 3 years, it's the antidepressant is used for life. But as regarding the aiding of modafinil, I usually use it till the symptoms is improved, like the symptoms of fatigue or tiredness. And then I gradually try to taper it gradually and see what's the response. If the patient returns to again, so I will keep the patient on the modafinil as he is using the antidepressant. The problem that there is some abusive potential of modafinil, we should take care of.
Thanks, doctor. Another question from Dr. Nahla. Any role of topiramate in decreasing migraine episodes associated with fibromyalgia?
Yes. The rule of topiramate as working as carbonic anhydrase inhibitor and potassium channel blocker, you can use it for treatment of migraine. But the problem that its side effect is it inducing depression and it inducing cognitive dullness. So if you are using a migraine patients or using topiramate in a migraine patient only for migraine, this is okay. But if the patient have a migraine and depression, you have a problem that because the cognitive impairment will increase and the memory impairment will increase and the cognitive dullness, and usually also it goes because it have decreased the potassium, so it increases the tingling sensations. And I see a lot of patients on topiramate come with an anxiety because of the tingling sensation of the periphery because of its side effects. So topiramate is effective, of course, and almost all the anticonvulsants is effective for migraine, particularly topiramate is FDA approved. But if the migraine is associated with depression or somatization, topiramate will not be the best choice.
Same asking person, Dr. Nahla asks you about both medications and the medications of fibromyalgia itself increase weight. Any medication can we add for that?
This is a very good questions, actually. She say that, as I understand, that the SNRI and the anticonvulsants, almost most of them increasing the weight. So we topiramate, it decreases the weight. The other is, there is, okay. So topiramate may decrease the weight, but I don't think that maybe ketamine does not increase the weight. And memantine does not increase the weight. So maybe you can use issue, but to use something to decrease the weight, we don't have any drug to decrease the weight except the topiramate.
Last two questions. We have many questions, but only last two questions for you. Can we use SNRI in mild fibromyalgia? And what are the best NSAIDs groups could be combined with SNRIs?
Okay. At the first part, yes, fibromyalgia, one of the approved medication is duloxetine, and milnacipran has been approved for fibromyalgia and for chronic fatigue syndrome. If you use the NASA, which is like the mirtazapine, may be effective, but not in a small dose, not as a sleeping, in a big dose, maybe in 45 milligram. Trazodone is sometimes effective because it's carrying the actions of mirtazapine and is carrying the action of tricyclic antidepressant. So it can be effective in the combination with SNRI. And I usually use a gabapentin and pregabalin for sleeping if the patient has a sleeping problem or to augmenting the pain. Carbamazepine and hexacarbamazepine also is effective for as adjuvant agent with the SNRI for fibromyalgia or chronic fatigue.
In relation to carbamazepine, there is a question about role of SNRIs with carbamazepine, although its side effects.
Yes. The main side effect of carbamazepine is inducing the metabolism of itself and the other medications like the SNRI. And so what's happening, if you are using, let's say, venlafaxine with carbamazepine, you will need to increase the dose of venlafaxine higher and higher. Maybe you reach to 300 milligram. And to give effect, because the carbamazepine is breaking or metabolizing this SNRI and the other like duloxetine, for example. So there is a drug-drug interaction. So the best is using better than carbamazepine. It's also carbamazepine or isli-zepine or isli-carbamazepine, which is the metabolites which have less drug-drug interactions. So using of carbamazepine, I agree with the question that it have a problem for the drug-drug interaction with the SNRI.
Thanks, doctor, for asking. And we will postpone the other questions for the future sessions. Let me end the fruitful night full of informative knowledge with Arabic. فشكرا جزيلا دكتور أسامة الخولي وأستاذ الطب النفسي جامعة اسكندرية على الكونتنت الرائع دوت، وشكرا لجميع الأطباء اللي شرفونا النهاردة في الأمسية الرمضانية دي، وشكرا للإيجيبشن سايكاتريك أسوسيشن ودكتور ممتاز عبد الوهاب ان هو يعني دايما على المحاضرات الدائمه، حتى ايفن في الاوقات اللي فيها جلوبال سيتويشن واوقات الكورونا والوركينج فروم هوم، ان دايما الجمعيه بتسبورت الساده الاطباء يعني. ولو حضرتك حابب دكتور اسامه تقول اي كومنت في الكلوز اتفضل.
والله انا يعني let me speak in Arabic also. طبعا لازم اشكركم جميعا على المجهود اللي بقالنا 3 4 ايام بالتليفونات عشان نطلع البرزنتيشنز ديت، واتمنى ان كنتوا ان انا ما كنتش طولت قوي ولا غلست قوي، ولا ويكون المعلومات اللي قلتها ذات قيمه للاطباء. بشكرك جدا يا محمود، وبشكر التيم بتاع فاركو والاورجنايزر كوميتي، وطبعا لازم اشكر الجمعية المصرية للطب النفسي وعلى رأسها أستاذي دكتور ممتاز عبد الوهاب، وكل التيم اللي شاركوني النهاردة. وبشكر طبعا الأودينس، معرفش أنا سهرتهم يعني كده، هنشتغل فيرشوال سحور بقى يعني، معرفش كده في فيرشوال سحور ولا لا، أعتقد فاركم ما عملتش فيرشوال سحور، معلش
نعمله برضه
إن شاء الله، نعمله فيرشوال سحور إن شاء الله. وبشكركم وأنا آسف على الإطالة، وأرجو أن أنا أكون أفدت بأي معلومة تكتب في ميزان حسناتي إن شاء الله.
إن شاء الله يا دكتور دايما، وشكرا جميعا جزيلا، وإلى اللقاء قريب إن شاء الله. السلام عليكم.